For as long as I can remember, I've been fascinated by these two abandoned railroad bascule bridges in downtown Cleveland. You can see them jutting into the sky while driving along the shoreway, at entertainment establishments in the flats, and in many photographs and advertisements. To many, they are considered icons and serve as a monument to the city's industrial heritage. But I've always wanted to know more about their history and had these two questions. Where exactly did this rail line run, and why and when were they abandoned? At Heritage Park, there's a small sign which lists some general facts about one of the bridges. However, being a history buff, this information wasn't enough. Come join me as I answer these questions while covering their history. So the two bridges we'll be talking about are numbered 464 and 463. In order to fully understand why they were built, we first have to go back to the year 1881. The Valley Railway Company, which stretched 76 miles from Cleveland to Zorville, Ohio, found themselves in a bit of a predicament. They jumped through several hoops just to gain access into downtown Cleveland, but had not reached their planned terminus at the Cleveland and Pittsburgh docks on Whiskey Island. You see, back in 1879, the company had leased part of the abandoned Ohio and Erie Canal bed from the city of Cleveland. This section stretched from near Independence Road to Merwin Avenue. The Valley Railway had filled the canal in with ballast so they could lay their tracks upon it. Once they reached the canal basin, which emptied into the Cuyahoga River by Merwin Avenue, they were out of land. This necessitated purchasing more land and constructing two bridges, one first over the Cuyahoga River by Merwin Avenue, and the final being at the entrance of the old river channel near Main Avenue. The railroad's solution to crossing over highly trafficked waterways during those times was by building iron swing bridges. So that is what the Valley Railway did in 1881 and 1882. While these bridges allowed railroads to cross rivers, they were expensive to build and more of a liability than an asset. Because their center piers were located in the river, it provided a narrow navigation channel on the already narrow Cuyahoga River. This increased the likelihood of lake boats striking both the pier and bridge. As tonnages of commodities hauled into Cleveland by lake boats skyrocketed in the early 1900s, they began increasing in size and length to carry more cargo at a time. To accommodate these larger boats, the Cuyahoga River had to be dredged so it could be widened and deepened. This happened multiple times over the years. Large boats trying to navigate into or out of the old river channel to reach the ore docks and shipyards found it increasingly difficult because of the Valley Railway swing bridge. After receiving many complaints from shipping companies about the bridge, the Cleveland Chamber of Commerce brought the matter to the attention of U.S. Secretary of War William Howard Taft in January of 1905. Both the U.S. Constitution and federal court rulings gave the federal government control over all navigable waterways under the Navigable Servitude Doctrine. The U.S. Army Corps of Engineers, which is tasked under federal law to improve these navigable waterways, has the right to regulate any bridges spanning across it. A public hearing before Major Dan C. Kingman from the Corps of Engineers was called by order of the War Department. The meeting took place at noon in the library of the Cleveland Chamber of Commerce building on March 13, 1905. There were representatives of about 25 shipping firms in attendance, including counsel from the Baltimore and Ohio Railroad. This was the Valley Railway's successor after they went bankrupt in 1895. Major Dan Kingman presided and acted as the government's representative. The railroad argued that because the present mouth of the Cuyahoga River, which was dug out in 1827, cutting off the old river channel from Lake Erie, was not subject to federal jurisdiction because it was man-made. Kingman concluded that the swing bridge must be removed and recommended it be replaced with a rolling lift bridge by April 1, 1906. Baltimore and Ohio objected to this date because they were planning to spend $1 million in terminal and dock facility upgrades within the vicinity of the existing swing bridge. They were concerned the new rolling lift bridge may interfere with this plan and asked that the requested installation date be pushed to April 1, 1907. Ultimately, in May of 1905, William Howard Taft had the final say and denied their request for an extension. Baltimore and Ohio then went ahead with replacing the bridge. under requirements issued by Dan Kingman, plans for a single-track, single-leaf Scherzer rolling lift bridge measuring 230 feet in length were approved by the War Department in August of 1905. Scherzer rolling lift bridges were a refined bascule-type bridge invented by Chicago engineer William Donald Scherzer. He patented his design and formed a company with the same name a few months before his death in 1893. His brother, Albert Scherzer, took over the business and built hundreds of examples around the world. In fact, even before B&O's Bridge 464 began construction, B&O had a double-track 160-foot Scherzer rolling lift bridge built by West 3rd Street in 1906. It is numbered 460 and replaced the Valley Railway's first swing bridge built by the King Iron Bridge and Manufacturing Company. 460 is Cleveland's only Scherzer rolling lift bridge still in operation under B&O's successor, CSX Transportation. In order to avoid interfering with lake boat and railroad traffic, Bridge 464 was constructed in its raised position. This was the same for all bascule bridges erected on the Cuyahoga River. When B&O Bridge 464 was completed on July 29, 1907, it was the longest single-leaf bascule bridge ever built. In contrast to the Valley Railway Swing Bridge, which had a center pier on the west bank of the river and a long approach at the opposite end, Bridge 464 provided a 210-foot clear channel. Since the B&O had already replaced two out of the three Valley Railway swing bridges, they began making plans in 1908 to replace the remaining one with another double-track Scherzer rolling lift bridge. This, of course, is Bridge 463 by Merwin Avenue. Its original plans called for it to be 180 feet long. However, under protest from Cleveland City engineer Robert Hoffman, he required it be extended to 200 feet. Hoffman was concerned its location on the east bank of the Cuyahoga River would interfere with the construction of the planned Detroit Superior Bridge and the widening of the river at Superior Point. Now officially known as the Veterans Memorial Bridge, this bridge effectively replaced the Superior Viaduct, which once had a center pier span that swung open for boats. The Veterans Memorial Bridge is tall enough that boats can pass under it without the need for a center pier swing span in the river. Bridge 463 began construction in July of 1910 and was completed in March of 1911. This bridge, however, is not the same current standing one many Clevelanders are familiar with. In 1956, the Board of the Corps of Engineers determined the 1911-built Scherzer Rolling Lift Bridge needed to be removed as the river channel at this point had been widened from 161 feet to 231.5 feet. Built in its place by the American Bridge Company is the existing 255-foot-long single-track Heel Trunnion Bascule Bridge on the west bank of the river. This impressive bridge was completed in 1957 at a total cost of about $3.3 million. It even came within 5 feet of beating the record for the longest bascule bridge set in 1919 by the St. Charles Airline Bridge in Chicago. It should be noted that this bridge was later shortened to 220 feet. So how exactly do bascule bridges work? Let's look at Bridge 464's specs as an example. The 230-foot span is balanced by these two concrete counterweights housed in steel boxes at its rear. Located on the span are two 75-horsepower alternating current electric motors, which make it raise or lower by turning its gearing system, known as the rack and pinion. The bridge tender engages the motors by a switchboard in a two-story shanty next to the bridge. As the bridge moves, it rolls on a fixed track resembling a rocking chair base. It is said in Scherzer Rolling Lift Bridge advertisements, the bridge can be raised or lowered within 30 seconds. Now, let's watch a video taken by my friend of Bridge 460 in action. Since Bridge 463 is a heel trunnion bascule bridge, it works a bit differently than Bridges 464 and 460. Unlike Scherzer rolling lift bridges, which had its counterweights mounted on the bridge, heel trunnion designs have them mounted on their own rotating framework. Additionally, the bridge and counterweights moved on their own separate pivots connected by links. This allows for these bridges to be raised nearly vertically. When in their raised position, they look like a jackknife, hence their nickname. Now, this leads us to the question of why and when bridges 464 and 463 were abandoned. As I mentioned earlier, the whole point of building these bridges was to access Whiskey Island. The Cleveland and Pittsburgh Railroad practically monopolized the island with their iron ore docks, with the exception of the Lakeshore and Michigan Southern Railway's main line passing through it. The Baltimore and Ohio Railroad and its predecessors ran transfer runs to exchange commodities with these railroads and their eventual successor, Conrail. While it's hard to believe today, at one time between both bridges 464 and 463, there was a railroad freight yard, freight depot, and a plethora of railroad tracks serving several industries, like the powerhouse. Once these industries closed, train traffic over the bridges plummeted. Eventually, on August 17, 1984, the B&O ran their last transfer run to Conrail on Whiskey Island. This was the last time both bridges were lowered and have been abandoned since. The tracks and terminal facilities have since been removed, and this area now mainly contains parking lots. At one point in the late 1980s, there was a plan to create a trolley line and museum called the Oldie River Railroad and Recreation Area, which would have utilized Bridge 463 to cross the river. It was a part of a major plan to link the nightclubs and restaurants on the west side of the flats with the ones on the east. The project never got off the ground. In 1996, both bridges 464 and 463 were among the 8 bridges in the flats to be illuminated by lights for Cleveland's bicentennial celebration. Each bridge was lit up in different colors and had their own special theme. Bridge 464's theme, for example, is the effect of a forge. It first displayed the color white, while it gradually changed over time to amber and red. Bridge 463's heel trunnion is displayed in magenta and blue, while its main span is lit in white, set to mimic an approaching ghost train. While both bridges are no longer in use today, they are impressive to admire and photograph. You can get up close and personal with them in the parking lot next to Shooters on the Water restaurant and Heritage Park. One lesser known vantage point is on the remaining portion of the Superior Viaduct by Bridge 463. If you made it to the end of this video, thanks for watching. To help support my channel, make sure to give this video a like and subscribe to Railroad Street for more videos just like this.